Namaskar, dear students, teachers, and other viewers from different parts of the country. I welcome you again to this Jigyasa webinar series, Let's Talk Science, What, Why, and How. Let me tell you again that this Jigyasa program is an outreach program of CSIR to inspire young minds towards science through a live interaction with the accomplished researchers, scientists, technical talks, and motivational talks. So today we are fortunate to have with us today's speaker, Dr. A.K. Srivastava, who is director at CSIR AMPRI, and he's going to talk about a very interesting topic, electron microscopy and spectroscopy. So let me take this opportunity to first introduce him in a brief. So Dr. Srivastava, he assumed as a director CSIR AMPRI in 2017. Before that, he was at CSIR NPL as senior principal scientist. Dr. Srivastava, he completed his MSc from IIT Roorkee, MTech in material science from IIT Kanpur, PhD in metallurgy from ISC Bangalore, and he has been credentialed. He is having several research papers to his credential and several awards to his credit. So without taking much of your time, I would now request sir to enlighten students about today's topic, which is electron and microscopy and spectroscopy. I think all these keywords are related to the topics the students they read in their class, starting from the 6th to the 12th class. So I request you to go ahead with your talk, please.
Good afternoon to all of you. Namaskar. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers, especially CSIR Jigyasa program, organizers from Delhi, organizers from Chandigarh, organizers from Bhopal, and giving me opportunity to talk, use this platform to talk about electron microscopy and spectroscopy. As I just came to know that the audience are from different range, very large range. And I'm sure along with them, their faculties and parents and maybe some scientists, some PhD students are also sharing this lecture series. So I don't know, sometimes my topic of this lecture maybe a bit harsh for some people, some sector, but it must be very soft for other sector. I'll try to keep balance because the students start from 6th standard to 12th standard, then PhD, then doctorate, and the senior scientists sitting all. So it's a complete package of scientists, from the future scientists to the mature scientists. Let me begin with CSIR itself first, because the students who are probably listening first time or who are quite new about CSIR, first they should know what is CSIR. So a few seconds I'll spend on that, and then Jigyasa, and then the topic of today's lecture. So CSIR stands for Council of Scientific and Industrial Research. It was established formally on 26 September 1942. Well before the independence. And by now, CSIR is having 38 labs, institutes across the country, 39 outreach centers, 3 innovation complexes, and 5 units. The president of CSIR is Honorable Prime Minister of the country, Sri Narendra Modi ji. The vice president is Honorable Minister of Science and Technology, Health and Family Welfare, Dr. Harshvardhan ji, and Honorable Director General CSIR and Secretary DSIR is Dr. Shekhar C. Mande. And I am heading the Institute of Advanced Materials and Process Research Institute at Bhopal. CSIR AMPRI is the only lab in Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh and dedicated on doing materials science and engineering. In short, we work on lightweight materials, nanostructured materials, smart and functional materials, and waste to value added materials. So this is in short, I wanted to say about CSIR and CSIR AMPRI. Coming to Jigyasa program, Jigyasa program officially started in July 2017, and it's a really excellent program. The MOU was signed between the two then ministers of Human Resource Development and Science Technology, CSAR. And the idea was to inculcate young minds in the field of science and technology. So the target was, or rather target is, that to reach to 1 lakh students per year and 1,000 faculties per year of Kendri Vidyalayas. But of late, now in recent March 2020, the Navoday schools have also joined MOU with CSAR, and they have joined hands under Jigyasa program along with Kendri Vidyalayas. In addition to that, whenever we have this Jigyasa program, we also try to promote and invite the other schools also in and around in the state. Recently, we had a Jigyasa program and we invited schools of Madhya Pradesh, Indore, and other private schools also, and they participated. So far, in Jigyasa program at CSIR AMPRI, in last 2.5 years, roughly, we have reached to more than 12,000 students and around 2,000 faculties and 300 schools. So it's a big number. And how do we reach to these students? We reach in the form of our organizing conferences, workshops. Sometimes we invite them on National Technology Day or National Science Day, or we have a big Bhopal Vigyan Mela, Bhopal Science Festival, where also students come. And last year, I think it's around 10,000 students came in that program itself. So that is how the CSIR Jigyasa program very successfully going on in CSIR AMPRI and in CSIR as well. So with this brief introduction, let me begin my talk, that is on electron microscopy and spectroscopy. I request my colleague to connect to the PowerPoint. So once again, I tell you that I am from Advanced Materials and Process Research Institute. It's one of the constituent lab of CSIR. It's located in Bhopal. We are going to talk on electron microscopy and spectroscopy. And this is very good technique for materials characterization. This lecture is under Jigyasa. And Jigyasa aim is to promote scientific temper through Student Scientist Connect program. Now, when we talk about any material, what are the steps and why we talk about material processing? Because we need certain application of a material. So the sequence goes like this. You decide about material, then how to process it, and then how to characterize. Characterization becomes very important just to know whether the material development is of your required property or not. So after characterization, you do properties evaluation. Sometimes there is back and forth experiments between characterization and properties evaluation. And then finally, when you find that your material is up to the mark of certain property, then you go for application. So there is a chain. Now, so characterization becomes very important. Among characterization, you have several characterization techniques, which you can categorize under microscopy, spectroscopy, macroscopy, and others. So we are going to touch upon a little bit today on microscopy. Spectroscopy, then it comes FTIR and also so on. Microscopy, other techniques are there, DTA, TGA, and then other properties. So we are going to touch upon only on microscopy. Under microscopy, you have scanning electron microscopy and transmission electron microscopy. Now, when you attach scanning electron microscope or transmission electron microscope with the spectroscopy technique like energy dispersive spectroscopy or electron energy loss spectroscopy, then you can understand the microstructure as well as the chemistry of the material. So spectroscopy in context with microscopy becomes very important when you want to have image spectrum analysis. Now, a little bit brief about the microscopes. I have even put the model of 1750 optical microscope. Before I go further, I just want to say that this today's lecture is basically tried to design for beginners. And here beginners are school children under this CSIR Jigyasa program. So it is similar to some extent a classroom teaching. There are several schematics, observations, including my own electron microscopy results, are put in to make a coherent and easy to grasp kind of lecture. All efforts are taken to mention the references wherever drawings and tables are taken from one source. However, at some points, there could be some references missing, and my apologies for that. So with this, I just want to show you that how different kind of microscopes are you can see on the screen. First two are optical microscope, 1750 model optical microscope you can see, and then the modern optical microscope. Under electron microscope, you have a scanning electron microscope and transmission electron microscope. And then of late, scanning probe microscope came where AFM and STM were brought in. Now, electron microscopy, what is the need of this? This is the technique that allows examination of samples too small to be seen with a light microscope. Why? Because in optical microscope, due to limitations of light optical microscope, magnification is only up to 500 to 1000x. It can go to up to 1200x or 1500x, depending on the lenses and all. And so the resolution is limited to about 0.2 micrometer or 0.1 micrometer. So if one has to see something beyond that, you need better microscope. So in early 1930s, first transmission electron microscope was developed in the exactly pattern of light transmission microscope. The scanning electron microscope was first developed in 1965 and late report due to complex electronics involved for the design of this microscope. Now, the wavelength concept is very important, and I know high school and 12th standard students at least now they know what is wavelength. Wavelength is the distance between peaks of the waveform. And in 1870 itself, it was derived mathematically that the resolution is limited to approximately half the wavelength of illuminating source. So if the wavelength is 400 micrometer, then the resolution is 200 micrometer and so on. Now magnification and resolution, if you multiply both, it should be approximately 0.1 mm. Why I'm trying to emphasize 0.1 mm? Because 0.1 mm or 0.2 mm is the human eye natural resolution, okay? Now, so suppose blue light has a wavelength of 470 nanometer. So resolution is around 200 nanometer. So this is the limit for optical microscope. In between, there were theories like theory of wave nature of electrons, and then the theory that axial magnetic fields refract electrons, and so on. So these kind of theories helped in developing the electron microscope. Now, when we talk about electron microscope, there has to be electron beam. And when electron beam is there, and it interacts with the specimen, what happens? Different signals come out. Now in electron microscope, either it is a scanning electron microscope or transmission electron microscope, the signals which are used are normally secondary electrons, backscatter electrons, and the characteristic X-rays for EDS, secondary electrons and backscattered electrons for scanning electron microscope, and the transmitted signals are used in transmission electron microscope. Now, if we look at the history, how difficult is to develop an instrument which is worth using, and it's ever live instrument which is always in demand. How much time it takes? In 1897, J.J. Thomson gave the discovery of the electron. Now in 1926, magnetic field, electric field as lenses were developed. In 1931, Noel Ruska built first transmission electron microscope, 1897 to 1931. So you can imagine it's about 35, 40 years. And they reported this findings in Journal of Physics in 1932. In 1932, Davison and Kalbrick built electrostatic lenses, and there are so many happenings, things happened. In 1939, Boris and Ruska, first commercial electron microscope with 10 nanometer resolution. Today we talk about 0.1 nanometer resolution. In 1945, 1.0 nanometer resolution. In 1946, 0.2 nanometer resolution, multiple organizations showed. And in 1968, University of Chicago, they developed a scanning transmission electron microscope with 0.3 nanometer resolution. So there is a difference between transmission electron microscope and scanning transmission electron microscope. I'll come to that point. In 1986, Ruska et al. Received Nobel Prize, and we are in 2009 with the resolution of 0.05 nanometer. So from 10 nanometer resolution, now we are at the resolution of 0.05 nanometer. So scanning electron microscopy, transmission electron microscopy, high resolution transmission electron microscopy, scanning transmission electron microscopy, these are very common words nowadays we use and we utilize in our day-to-day materials research. We can club these instruments with EDS, energy dispersive spectroscopy, and our electron energy loss spectroscopy, so you can understand to some extent the chemistry of the material also. This example of a Nova NanoSEM, which shows 1 nanometer resolution. There is another example of EVO MA10, 3 nanometer resolution in secondary electron mode, 4.5 nanometer resolution in backscattered electron mode, and one can go up to magnification of 1000 kilo-X. So the magnification is not that important. Normally people say at what magnification you have recorded the image, but you can go up to 1 lakh magnification. But if resolution is not good, you don't get good quality of image, then just going to higher magnification doesn't solve the purpose. But you can have now a specimen stage that is 5-axis stage. So you can rotate, tilt, you can have X, Y, X movement, Y movement, Z movement. This is inside cross-sectional view of a microscope. Scanning electron microscope, so it starts with the electron gun. Then you have systems for gun alignment, pneumatic air valves, condenser lens, objective aperture, scanning coil, objective lens, motorized stage, and sample chamber. Now, in scanning electron microscope, once beam falls and you want to study your specimen, three most important signals are secondary electrons, backscattered electrons, and X-rays. Secondary electrons gives you an image which gives you a topological contrast of your surface microstructure of your specimen. Then backscattered electrons gives you compositional contrast and to some extent topographical contrast also. And X-rays are used basically for the spectroscopy. energy dispersive spectroscopy. Now, this cartoon shows that how you get different contrast when you are in a secondary electron image mode and backscattered electron image mode. So in one, in the upper part, if you see my this cursor, the amount of secondary electrons emitted from these are different kind of contours on the surface. One is a valley, one is the hill, and you get the contrast accordingly. So that is the contrast developed because of the contours on the surface of your specimen. But in case of backscattered electrons, the contrast is developed depending on the elements present. So like carbon, iron, gold. Heavier the element, you have the different contrast. So from black to white, you are having different contrast. So accordingly, the image also changes. In case of, this is an alloy of aluminum, manganese, silicon, where you have aluminum matrix, and aluminum, manganese, silicon is an intermetallic. Now, in case of secondary electron image, you get a microstructure, but when you get a backscattered electron image of same microstructure, you see a different contrast because here the distribution of intermetallics, which is white patches, is clearly shown in the matrix, which is dark, or one can say black kind of gray contrast, which is aluminum. So contrast is changing when you go from secondary electron mode to backscattered electron mode. That is the beauty of scanning electron microscope. Now, this is another example of secondary electron mode image, that a cuboid of cadmium oxide, it's in nano to micro scale. But if you are a good operator, although image is a two-dimensional image, but you can get a three-dimensional view. Similarly, this is the example of same cadmium oxide processed under different conditions. These are the nanorods of the cadmium oxide. Now, another image shows here again the backscattered images with a combination of energy dispersive spectroscopy. So here, if you go to the image B, the down second image, you see the flakes, you see the rods, and then background is dark. Now this contrast, flakes have a different kind of the composition, gray plates. Matrix has a different kind of composition, that is aluminum. And these rods, bright plates, we are calling here, they are iron rich, and they have a different kind of composition. So a good combination of secondary electron image, backscattered electron image and EDS can give you really a good knowledge about the microstructure and the chemistry of your material, whatever is happening or happened on the surface of your specimen. Now, energy dispersive spectroscopy, little bit, one or two slides I'll show you here, that this spectroscopy is basically the energy you get. These are the characteristic X-rays, and these X-rays are emitted because when incident electron eject an electron from the element present in the microstructure, and the other electron from the higher orbit goes to fill up that stage, then the energy difference that is measured, and that is used for your energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy. I will not go into detail of this table, but it clearly shows how precisely CuK alpha like will have energy of 8.047 kilo electron volt, whereas CuK alpha 2 will have 8.027 kilo electron volt, and so on. One can calculate the energy from these simple equations from energy EH nu, and nu is C by lambda, and so on. And so generation and detection of X-rays, that is, I have shown from that schematic itself. Now, this I have taken from literature, and but easily anybody can generate this kind of microstructure. But somehow I really like this picture, that this is a filament which you are seeing under microscope, under focus condition at 10x. When magnification is only 10 magnification, 10x. Now, when you focus one layer, and go to the magnification 110x, you get a different kind of microstructure. Further, when you magnify at 200x, you get a different kind of microstructure. And at 400x, you get a different kind of microstructure. Now we are focusing on this region. And further you go 16K, 45K, and so on. Now, the magnification which you had seen the microstructure at 10x is entirely different now, the microstructure which you see at the magnification at 45K. So what does it say? It clearly says that it is very important for the microscopist when he or she is going to the microscope, person should know clearly what is the interest, what kind of information the person wants to know from the microscope. Otherwise, if you look at 45,000, you will get a different kind of information. If you look at 10 magnification, you get a different kind of information. You look at 200 magnification, you get a different kind of information. So this micrograph, I really like it, and I always try to show that whenever you go to the microscope, you should know about your material and you should have roughly some idea what you are looking for. Otherwise, it's like an ocean and you will just keep hunting the required information. This is another example that in the microscope, without even coating of the material, normally we coat it because otherwise there is charging. I will not be able to go in every aspect of the microscope. But I can tell you, normally we use conducting specimen, but non-conducting specimen also you can see in the scanning electron microscope. And these are some examples from leaf and wood. Nowadays, environmental specimen and the low vacuum specimens, you can see in the microscope at low KV. And these are the examples that leaf and wood kind of specimen also you can see under the microscope. Otherwise, normally when you look at the ceramic sample, which is again non-conducting, you have to make a coating, or even a semiconducting material you want to use study in the microscope, you have to do a coating to make it conducting. Now coming to the transmission electron microscope. So in scanning electron microscope, we are bothered about the surface. We look at the surface microstructure, surface chemistry. In case of transmission electron microscope, the electron beam passes through the specimen. So the specimen has to be very thin and it has to be around 50 to 100 nanometer thick, not more than that for a routine TM. And if you want to have a very good microscopy at atomic scale and so on, then a specimen has to be 5 to 10 nanometer even thick. Now here, the most important mode of characterization is bright field, then you have dark field, and selected area electron diffraction pattern is in the inverse space, reciprocal space, and then convergent beam electron diffraction, which is very important technique for understanding the symmetry and all. Now here it is the photograph of Professor Ruska, received Nobel Prize in 1986. He got although he built the first TM in 1931, but the Nobel Prize was given in 1986 only. Now, here it shows the picture of one picture of cadmium oxide on a MgO substrate. This is a bright field image, and then corresponding selected area electron diffraction pattern. So understanding the microstructure, understanding the electron diffraction pattern, you can have easily structure microstructure analysis. Now again, very important and interesting electron diffraction patterns. If you are little bit aware about the electron diffraction pattern in transmission electron microscope, normally you get one of these electron diffraction. And depending on that, you decide, you say whether your material is amorphous or polycrystalline or crystalline, or nowadays you can also say quasicrystalline. Now, when your electron diffraction pattern shows a diffuse hollow ring, you can say your material is amorphous. When it is polycrystalline, means there are rings, and these rings are constituted of very fine spots. So these rings are nothing but the atomic planes. Now, in case of crystalline or single crystalline pattern, you have well-defined periodic spacing of these spots. Now, quasicrystalline pattern has a long range. It has got a rotational periodicity, but there is no translational periodicity. Means if you see the distance between the two bright spots and then next bright spot, you see that this distance is not equal. So this is not periodic. These are quasi-periodic structures. So this is a new dimension given in the crystallography. Earlier to that, before quasi-crystalline symmetry came into picture in 2011, formally, probably I should say, although it was first reported in 1984, but in 2011, the group got the Nobel Prize. I'll come to that later. Earlier to that, we knew 7 lattice systems and corresponding 14 Bravais lattices, cubic, hexagonal, tetragonal, rhomboidal, orthorhombic, monoclinic, and triclinic. But a quasi-crystal is a structure that is ordered but not periodic. That is what I said by showing the electron diffraction pattern. Now, the person, Professor Shetman, along with his group, Blesch and Gassius, they reported first time in 1984 in Physical Review Letter in aluminum manganese based alloy, rapidly solidified, that there is a quasi-crystalline symmetry. And they showed the diffraction pattern having 5-fold rotational symmetry, icosahedron quasi-crystalline symmetry. And they also did a lot of exercise in understanding and analyzing those patterns. And the group received Nobel Prize in 2011, precisely on 5th October 2011. And this is very precious notebook. This is the notebook, Xerox copy of the notebook of Professor Daniel Shetman of 8th April 82, when first time he recorded this diffraction pattern. And in his own handwriting, I believe, he was trying to analyze this pattern. So very precious notebook, 8th April, 1982. And this is the title of the paper in 1984, which he published in Physical Review Letters, Metallic Phase with Long Range Orientational Order and No Translational Symmetry. Shetman, Blesch, Gassius, and Kahn, and they reported this in Physical Review Letter, but it took a long time to convince the scientific community that yes, quasi-crystalline symmetry do exist. This is of late in 2011 on aluminum, palladium, manganese, how this atomic model the Professor Shetman has shown using a modern transmission electron microscope, the arrangement of the atoms in quasi-crystalline symmetry. We also did a lot of work in this direction those days in early 90s. And there is a good theory and then experimental evidences that there are crystals that if they show irrational twinning, they can also lead to quasi-crystalline symmetry. So the A set of patterns, 5-fold, 3-fold, 2-fold, this is from icosahedral quasi-crystalline symmetry. And this is from the irrational twinning of crystalline symmetry, aluminum, manganese, silicon. But they say they show similar to the quasi-crystalline symmetry. So these are our observations, which we published in, I think, in 1996, long back. Now, coming to another class of materials, fullerene, where again the Nobel Prize was given in 1996. Fullerene is nothing but It's one of the form of allotrope of carbon having 60 atoms cluster. Now, it is basically called as Buckminster fullerene. It was reported in by Croteau et al. In 1985 in Nature. And this structure was reported by spectroscopy observation, whereas the quasicrystalline structure was reported by electron microscopy observation. Now, in 1996, the Nobel Prize Committee decided to give this group, Carl, Harald, and Richard Smiley, to give Nobel Prize for the discovery of the fullerene. This structure is similar to a football kind of a structure, where you can place the carbon atoms, especially 60 atoms. It is having 32 faces, 12 of which are pentagonal and 20 hexagonal. And the diameter of this fullerene structure, one cluster from nucleus to nucleus, is around 0.71 nanometer. Now, so again, I am showing D structure is fullerene. And in 1991, Ijima and group in Japan, they came out another structure of carbon nanotube, again, allotrope of carbon, but this is a two-dimensional nanomaterial, whereas fullerene is a three-dimensional nanomaterial. So fullerene was reported using spectroscopy techniques. Quasicrystal structures were reported by electron microscopy technique. Carbon nanotube were reported by electron microscopy technique. Now, this was the high result. This is high resolution TEM. I again try to show this picture again and again, because this was the first high resolution TEM we could install in NPL when I was there. It was in 2006 or 2007 sometime. And the resolution is 0.205 nanometer. Now, the planes, these fine lines, are nothing but atomic planes of gold. And the separation which we could resolve here up to 0.144 nanometer and 0.12 nanometer. Now, so SEM to some extent we covered, transmission electron microscope we covered. Now it is scanning transmission electron microscope. Why do we say scanning transmission electron microscope? Because here beam is in scanning mode, like in SEM, but in transmission electron microscope. Okay, so that is why it is called scanning transmission electron microscope. So STM is distinguished from conventional TEM by focusing the electron beam into a narrow spot, which is scanned over the sample in a raster. And it is very good technique if you attach along with EDS or EELS, so you can do very good elemental mapping. Now, there is a history beyond STM also. And this, I again always say that there is a sentimental history also along with this. I have taken from literature this table, but I'm not able to recall the reference. But you see, 1938, first STM was built by Manfred in Berlin. However, at the time, the results were inferior to those of TEM. And von Erdem only spent 2 years working on the problem. In 1944, the microscope was destroyed in an air raid, and von Erdem did not return to his work after World War II. So sad. 1970, Albert Crewe at University of Chicago developed FEG to create a modern STM, and he demonstrated the ability to image atoms using an annular dark field imaging, in short, we call ADF. And now, by now, in 2000, 0.136 nanometer resolution. What is the advantage? You have TEM, you have SEM, then what is the need of STM? First thing, image spectrum analysis you can do perfectly, even at very fine nanoscale. If you have even one nanometer, or 0.5 nanometer lead nanoparticle in aluminum matrix, you can do very fine mapping and you can identify where are all lead nanoparticles are distributed in aluminum matrix. I'll show you some examples. I will not go in this slide because it's a lot of text is there. But I'll just show you that, I'll tell you that in case of high resolution TEM, the whole mechanism is phase contrast imaging based, where you know the amplitude plays a very important role. Whereas in case of a scanning transmission electron microscope, it is Z contrast imaging. What is Z here? Atomic number contrast. Heavier the atom will have a better contrast than, will have different contrast than the lighter the atom, which is not the case in case of phase contrast imaging. Now, if you have a scanning transmission electron microscope, annular dark field detector, along with electron energy loss spectrometer, EELS, you can do very good image spectrum analysis. So EELS as a STM measurement technique made possible with the addition of an electron spectrometer, the high energy, convergent electron beam in STM provides local information of the sample, even down to atomic dimension. Now I'll not read this in detail, but what I want to tell you that in EELS, when you get the spectrum, you can divide low loss energy spectrum and higher energy spectrums. Low loss energy spectrum, we call it as energies between 5 to 50 electron volt, that is from the upper levels, low losses, from upper levels to the conduction band. And this kind of energy losses are important to measure electron density, optical and localized surface electronic properties. And edges occurring at higher energy, like 50 to 5,000 electron volt, this works exactly as EDS, more or less, and it gives you elemental identification. Now, low loss energy, very important. And the importance you can see from these figures, that here is the example of titanium. It can have 3+ state or 4+ state in the compound. You have Ti2O3, TiO2, CaTiO3. Now, if you do EDS, then what will happen? You will get a nice peak of titanium and nice peak of oxygen. But here, if you have Ti2O3 and you see the geometry of peak in Ti2O3 and in TiO2, where Ti is 4+ state, geometry of peak at around 464 electron volt are different. So you can differentiate between Ti2O3 and TiO2. In case of CaTiO3, you have again 4+ state. Another example is allotropes of carbon, graphite, C60, diamond. If you do EDS, carbon is a carbon. You get around 284 electron volt, a nice peak of carbon. But in EELS, from the EELS data, you can differentiate from this peak geometry whether it is graphite or C60 or diamond. Now, another example of EELS with STM. You see this first picture where cursor is there, A to B. You have a carbon nanotube and in between it is filled with something. Now, you can do the spectra analysis. Like from A to B, it's about 30 nanometer distance. And A to B, we have recorded 64 spectra. And each spectra is recorded at a distance of 3 angstrom. So when you record that, you get a peak in the length of about 10 nanometer. You see my cursor here, if you are able to see. And so from this, you can easily say that between this 10 nanometer, there is a manganese field in carbon nanotube. Otherwise, you cannot say what is the filling, what element is filled inside carbon nanotube, and what is the diameter of this filled element inside the carbon nanotube. Now, this electron microscope is really a very unique technique which resolves so many things, I can tell you. This is the example of titanium nitride. You have a thin film of titanium nitride, about 40 nanometer thick film, and then silicon substrate. In between this white line shows you a interface, very thin interface, about 1 to 2 nanometer. But if you do the cross-sectional TEM, you can easily resolve titanium nitride and silicon even at atomic scale. And if you take the this composite electron diffraction pattern, you can record the diffraction pattern from the fine grains of titanium nitride, which are about 4 to 5 nanometer. And that is why it gives a polycrystalline diffraction pattern, these rings. And this spotty pattern is from the silicon substrate because it's a silicon, it's a single crystalline silicon substrate. We can do mapping. We can do elemental analysis using yields, even in the length scale of 1.1 nanometer size. In the area of 1.1 nanometer size, you can do the elemental mapping. And elemental analysis as well as mapping. So if we compare yields, electron energy loss spectroscopy and energy dispersive spectroscopy, yields is spoken as being complementary to EDS. EDS is good. It gives you good, it gives you to identify atomic composition of a material, quite easy to use. And in most of the microscopes, you will find EDS, not yields. Yields is known, but nowadays, I mean, I think if you read carefully and study very well, it's no more a difficult technique, but historically, it is known as a difficult technique, but is in principle capable of measuring atomic composition, chemical bonding, valence and conduction band electronic properties, and surface properties. The difference in performance between yields and EDS is mainly due to the difference in energy resolution between the two techniques. And that is a big difference. In case of yields, you can resolve up to 1 electron volt or better. Whereas in case of EDS, you can resolve 130 electron volt or better. So that is why even a fine peak of titanium, as I showed that reference figure, you can resolve the peak, and from the geometry of the peak itself, you can tell whether titanium is in 3+ state or in 4+ state, and that is not possible if you do the EDS. There are some more examples. I'll just go through quickly that when you add iron in zinc oxide and by changing the microstructure from pyramidal to nanoparticle, at same time, the new phase is also generated in addition to hexagonal ZNO, cubic ZnFe2O4 phase is also added. And this is helpful in understanding the property because structure property correlation is very important. Here, I'm just focusing about the microscopy part, but why microscopy we do? Because the structure property correlation is very important. And where microscopy plays a very important role. So this is just one example that photoluminescence, ZNO, bare ZNO gives you orange emission, whereas 0.5% iron add gives you green, 2% blue, and when you keep on adding further iron, it changes to another colors. Now, so we try to analyze, and we find that this is happening because when you add, keep on adding iron, there are extra energy states introduced between the valence band and conduction band of bare ZNO. And they are because of the deficient oxygens, O2 minus, O minus, and then interstitial zincs, these radiative defects, and so on. So because of these regions, you get extra colors in photoluminescence. This is, many times we say that nanomaterials show different properties because of the defects present there. So we tried to do high resolution TEM in many cases at atomic scale. And in some cases, we also find that it's not the question of only the defect. There could be some other reason also. Like this is a particle of about 40 nanometer length. And at atomic scale, you can see the clean image, atomic scale. And this interplanar spacing is about 0.24 nanometer. And here you have a selected area electron diffraction pattern along C axis, that is 0001 zone axis of ZNO hexagonal structure. We have gone further beyond that. Because ZNO is a non-centrosymmetric hexagonal crystal, and that is why it gives properties like piezoelectric. We tried to find out the spacing between zinc ions and oxygen ions. And to the some extent, we were successful. And first time in real space, we were able to calculate the spacing along the Z axis of Zn plus 2 and O minus 2. And it comes out 0.198 nanometer in real space. There could be some instrumental error of plus minus 5% or so. Then this is the example of ZNO nanoparticles, graphene-based composite. You have ZNO nanoparticles and in the graphene. And how to know that there is a good distribution of ZNO nanoparticle in graphene? So you can record bright field image. You can do electron diffraction pattern. These rings are from the ZNO and these spots are from the graphene. You can do the high resolution atomic scale imaging. And you do the mapping. If mapping shows the presence of carbon, oxygen, zinc homogeneously, means you have developed a good material. This example, initial work mine where we were trying to grow antimony nanoclusters of different size from nucleation to growth. And this work really got appreciated even in science. And here we could show that depending on the size of the clusters of the antimony, you can have different kind of the petals, the kind of the islands and then the dendrites structures and so on. Another example, this silver nanoparticles, we tried to trap intentionally in the graphene. And the idea was here, you can see two graphene sheets. And in between silver nanoparticle is trapped. Idea was to how to change the spacing between the graphene sheets. And so here we could show that if you have different size of the nanoparticles, although they will change the property also, so that part one has to be careful. But by changing the size of the nanoparticle, you can change the spacing between the graphene sheet and it becomes like a spacer. The titanium oxide, here is the example that coated with the 25 nanometer thick silicon oxide. And this kind of observation you can make only using transmission electron microscope in bright field imaging. You see the titanium oxide coated with 25 nanometer thick silicon oxide. The elemental mapping you can do. And even from a spectrometer, this spectrometer itself, you can see that the thickness is about 22 to 25 nanometers. Maybe I'm having some time limitation, but I'll just quickly go through a few more slides. This is a nano silicon carbide added with MgB2 superconductor. I just want to show you that how the transmission electron microscope and electron microscope itself is so useful for understanding the material and material property as such. So when we added nano silicon carbide and in MgB2, there is a reaction of MgB2 with nano silicon carbide, which makes Mg2Si. There is MgB2 itself, and there is a silicon carbide as such. So three kind of phases we could find after the mixing of silicon carbide with MgB2. And you see the nice interface between MgB2 and silicon carbide. So that shows that there is a good interface between MgB2 and silicon carbide. So the properties should also be good. In addition to that, I could get some chance to work on scanning helium microscope. This is similar to scanning electron microscope, but here instead of electron beam, you would use helium ion. And that time it was quite old image now. It's about a 10-year old image now. The resolution was 0.34 nanometer, that time itself of this helium ion microscope. That time the scanning electron microscope, we used to talk resolution about 1 nanometer or 2 nanometer. That time itself, the helium ion microscope showed resolution of 0.34 nanometer. And we use this on graphene. And even you can do the, you can do writing also. Helium ion you can use for nano patterning. And here we could write Rashtriya Bhautik Prayogshala at a length scale of 100 nanometer with a letter gapping of 7 nanometer. This will be quite interesting to the school kids. This is a unique microscope still I think available in Osaka University. And it's a multi-story microscope. And here the accelerating voltage goes up to 3 million volt. And the sample could be relatively thick. Instead of nanometer, even micrometer thick sample can go inside this. But the idea of using this kind of microscope is to study the energy beam effect on the specimen. So here is steel samples were tried that time, and to study how the dislocation moves in steel samples at the gain boundaries and other places too. Some of the electron microscopy results on nanostructure materials you can see in this book. And this is one slide. In total, I want to tell you about CSIR AMPRI, although I told in the beginning that we work on lightweight materials, smart and functional materials, nanostructure materials, and waste to value added materials under 6 different divisions. Lightweight metallic materials, advanced construction materials, radiation shielding and cement free concrete materials, smart and functional materials, integrated approach for design and product development. And we also have a group called Water Resource Management and Rural Technologies. Of late, we have transferred several technologies on bamboo composite, non-toxic radiation shielding materials, cement-free concrete materials. Then one technology recently we transferred on surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy. We have transferred a technology on nano alumina adsorbent water filter. And these days, this COVID-19 problem is going on. We have developed a special kind of sanitizer. That technology also we have transferred. And several other technologies like process for making advanced radiation shielding materials, paver blocks, hybrid composite, process for making aluminum silicon carbide composite, hybrid composite materials, high performance hybrid composite materials, MRT for sugar mills, and cement free concrete. Several technologies we have transferred in the past. And in addition to that, we are publishing very good papers. So in total, CSIR AMPRI is in the field of processing, characterization, testing and evaluation, simulation and modeling. And most recently, you know, in last 2 to 3 months, the whole world is under the crisis and facing the problem of coronavirus, COVID-19. And this is one Indian group have recorded the coronavirus picture in transmission electron microscope. This is under focus and defocus condition. Why we record in defocus condition also to get some more features which are important, which we may not be able to see under focus condition. We have also published a paper very recently in Science Reporter. And this paper basically is a thought-provoking paper which states about, can graphene-based materials play a major role in fight against COVID-19? So you can go through all these papers to make yourself more aware about the coronavirus. As I said in the beginning, that the students of Kendri Vidyalayas, Navoday schools, and other schools are attracted to these labs, especially AMPRI, on different occasions. National Technology Day, National Science Day, and conferences dedicated for them. This is example of Bhopal Vigyan Mela, Bhopal Science Festival, we call it, where even more than 10 CSIR labs participated in September. And students from KVs and other government and private schools and colleges of Bhopal participated. And this number was about 10,000. And there were more than 50,000 footfall during this 4 days Bhopal Vigyan Mela. And very prominent and very senior personalities visited. Honorable Minister of Government of Madhya Pradesh, Sri P.C. Sharma Ji, Honorable Minister of Panchayat and Rural Development, Kamleshwar Patel Ji, and Honorable former Governor of Haryana and Tripura, Kaptan Singh Solanki Ji, Dr. Naveen Chandra, and then Mission Directors, Mission Shakti, DRDO, Dr. Raja Babu, and there are so many big personalities, they visit this, and ISRO, DRDO, DAE, all these labs, they come, they participate in this 4 to 5 days program. Now, this is most recent, although now it is a 3-year-old story, but let me share that the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 2017 was given to Jacques, Joachim, and Richard for developing cryo-electron microscopy for the high-resolution structure determination of biomolecules in solution. So with this, thank you very much for your kind attention, and I would be happy to take any question. And if there is a time limitation, so I would be happy to take questions on my email, which is very simple, director@ampri.res.in. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for such a nice comprehensive talk and very simply explaining different concepts related to electron microscopy and spectroscopy. So since we have time limitation, so there are only few couple of questions we can take. So I would request you to address those questions. So first question that comes from is, are there any microscopes stronger than the electron microscope?
Repeat.
Are there any microscope stronger than electron microscope, or the electron microscope are amongst the strongest one? The resolution, or I think that may be the student trying to ask.
Yeah, it depends in what terms you want to know. If you specify resolution, then definitely the electron microscope are the best microscopes, where you can go up to 0.05 resolution. So that is the best thing. And also the thing is, here you study in real space and reciprocal space both. That is the biggest advantage. You know X-ray diffraction, right? It's in reciprocal space. Okay. But here, suppose you have a microstructure and then you want to study that. What is in this microstructure? In real space, you can go in depth up to atomic scale and you can study what is the structure up to atomic scale. Okay. That is sub-nanoscale. At same time, you can take electron diffraction pattern. And in reciprocal space, you can clearly find out the geometry, crystallography of that area. In addition, when you have spectroscopy added with that, you can understand even sub nanoscale, what is the chemistry of that microstructure? What are all elements are there? Even at the grain boundaries, interface, what are all elements are present? So in that way, that is why electron microscopy becomes a very strong tool in characterization.
Absolutely.
So in that way, this answers the first question also. If you combine all these parameters in one tool, I think this is very strong technique of materials characterization.
Right, sir. So there is another question related to the nature of electrons, which is used in electron microscopy. Like in school, it is told dual nature and particle nature of electron. So in microscopy, what nature of the electron is used?
What I said, resolution. So resolution is half of the wavelength of the electron, wavelength of the source. So here, now you want me to go to my school days probably. If I remember exactly, the wavelength, and not school days, but my early M.Tech days at least, the wavelength at 100 kilovolt, if you calculate, it is 0.034 angstrom, if I am correct. A little bit here and there. At 200, 0.037, I think. At 200 kV, it is 0.025, something like that. Now, so half of that wavelength is the resolution. Okay, but we don't get that result. 0.03 means half of that, 0.01. But in a normal TEM, normal good TEM, you get 0.1 nanometer. Why? Because several aberrations, astigmatism, aberrations, lenses, alignment, all those things. So all those factors coming together, then they make the resolution 0.1 nanometer or 0.2 nanometer and so on. So wavelength, so rest part, I leave to that student.
Yes, sir. So going ahead with the next question. So like you told, like in electron microscopy, the scattered electrons are captured.
Yes.
So the question is, then in that case, the image should be distorted. Then how we see high quality images, because the electrons are scattered in different direction. But the image we get is of high quality. How it happens?
Yeah. What happens? Image is why? Because there are series of electromagnetic lenses. Condenser lens, objective lens, diffraction lens. So at every stage, I did not cover the inside instrumental part of the microscope. At every stage, there are lenses, projector lens, condenser lens, objective lens. So they keep condensing the beam. Okay, so that is why the scattering is every step, it is minimized. So you get a focus beam. Because of the presence of electromagnetic lenses at every stage in the microscope.
Right, sir. So now the last question, since we have time restriction. So do the property of the material which we characterize changes when the electron beam falls into it?
Yeah. Property of the material may change. If I take this question loosely. Okay. But the thing is, you see, if a biospecimen is there, biospecimen, life science material. So it's a soft material. If a metallic material is there, let's say steel is there. Okay. So, you know, every material has a thermal stability after all. A biomaterial may burn at relatively at very low temperature, whereas steel will not burn at very high temperature also. So that is why the microscopes, they are used at different kilovolt, electron accelerating voltage. In SEM also, you can go from 5 kilovolt to 40 kilovolt. Why? Because soft matters, you have to deal at low kV. Hard matters, you can deal at high kV. In transmission electron microscope, you can go from 80 kV to 300 kV, 80 kilovolt to 300 kilovolt. So you have to change the accelerating voltage. And if you are, your lab, your institute is dedicated for biomaterials, so you choose a configuration of electron microscope in such a way that that is dedicated for biomaterials. But similar kind of configuration may not work for the scientists, the faculties who are working on metallurgical materials. Okay, so there are different configurations, because if high energy falls, your material gets burned, then definitely properties are changed. You will not be able to see the actual microstructure which you are looking for.
Thank you very much, sir, for patiently answering all the questions. And I request now participants, if you have more questions, sir already gave his mail ID, so you can write to sir directly. So I thank you very much, sir, for your time, such a nice talk and answering all the questions. And I also thank Satananji for coordinating this talk from AMPRI. I also thank my viewers, students, teachers who have been with us for last 1.5 hours and putting many questions. Due to time constraint, we couldn't take more, but you can write directly to sir. So next we will be meeting next Monday on 25th May with a new speaker and new exciting topic. Thank you very much.
Thank you.